Let's join together in our call to worship. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you.
I want to welcome all of you into this time, this place of worship. May this worship inspire and challenge and lead each of us to live out our commitments to Jesus. Last week, the book of Ruth, we began that study, and right away we recognized loyalty as a major theme, a loyalty to not just another person, but a loyalty to Jesus. And in that loyalty, in that relationship, what we discover and what we find again and again is that we belong. We have a place that we belong, a house where love can dwell and all can safely live. This week, in the second chapter of Ruth, we hear the theme of being included and sharing what God has given to us. And that's a critical piece to know this week or any week, that we are blessed to be a blessing, we hear from Scripture. So listen, I invite you to come and worship. If you've been here for the first time, then be part of this community this Sunday, this week, in which we hear about a man by the name of Boaz. Listen to how he lived out a generous life, sharing his resources with someone who was far different than he. Listen as we are called to share our time, our skills, and our resources each and every day. We at Farmington Lutheran come together so that we can be not just sustained, but empowered to live out that life of generosity in where we work, where we live, where we go to school, where we shop, wherever we might be. Welcome. Welcome into this time of worship.
We have a Lord with whom we know we can turn to and we can seek help. And so at this time, let's join together and share our words of confession as we anticipate our Lord's forgiveness. Blessed be the Trinity, one God whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen. Amen. And trusting now in the mercy of God, let's pause and confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, hear this good news, that by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
This is the time that we invite children, and I would even say the youth, and maybe even a few adults into this conversation to help us understand what we hear today in the Bible, in that book of Ruth, chapter 2, and what we have continued to hear from God week upon week. And so the idea is that God calls us to be people who share, who are willing to give to others for the sake of others, for the care of others. And that's what living out a Christ-like life can look like. And so I thought about that, and I thought about something I really like. Besides chocolate, I like these Tootsie Pops, or whatever they're called nowadays. They're just good tasting, and they have a good surprise in the middle. And I discovered I had quite a few of them. I don't know if you can get a good closer shot on that, but I've got a number of them. Probably would last me a whole bunch of days, not just if I just had one a day. These would last me over 2 weeks. That's quite a bit, isn't it? Now, I don't know what you have at home. I have a whole drawer of chocolate, and it seems to never end. It just keeps being there. So I thought of these as a way to help me understand God's way of living. If I take these and I take them out, I have 20 of them in here, by the way. So if I take them out and I say, I'm going to keep some for myself. Okay, I don't know. You decide. You decide how many of 20 would be reasonable to keep. Okay, your parents are probably saying none, but I'm going to let you just at least choose a number here. And let's say half, keep 10. Let me see what 10 looks like. Let me see, 2, 4, 6, 8. Oh my goodness. That's a pretty good amount of lollipops. 10 looks like a good number, but let's say I get a little more interested and I want to keep some more. And let's say I keep all but two. I keep all these. I mean, I get rid of these. Oh, I keep these and I get rid of these. And I don't just get rid of them. I find someone that might enjoy them as well and I give them to. So I have two out of 20. Now, this is where the youth are important. I'm not sure if I've just spent about 3 days with a 10-year-old and I wonder if she could do the math, but what's the percentage? Two out of 20 is what? Craig, you're in the back there. Help me out. What's two out of 20? 10%. I don't know if you heard his voice. 10%. That's an interesting number. We hear that number every so often in our life as a church. So all of these are mine, and these I can share. And I think if we look at other things in our life, toys, other candy that you might have, and how about your time? You know how many minutes are in a day? How many hours are in a day? So could you think of how much time could you give or share to help or to care for someone else? Maybe it's some time you give to your parents. Maybe it's only 2 minutes or 5 minutes to clear the table, or what if it's making cookies and bringing them to a neighbor, and you use both your time and some of your resources? This is what God is calling for. In the story that we hear in Ruth chapter 2, Boaz is a guy who owns a lot of fields, it seems like. He seems to have a lot. And what he chooses to do is to give some of it away so that others could have what they need. And I don't think that's a small part of this story. I think it's a constant reminder to us throughout the Bible and throughout our life in faith that God is calling for us to look at ways that we could use what we have been given so that others too can enjoy. So I'm going to challenge you this week to find something that you have in your house. Maybe it's some toys, maybe it's some money, maybe it's some candy. I don't know what it might be. Maybe it's some time. And find a place, a person that you can share those gifts with. Will you do that? Let's pray, because we need prayer to help us keep thinking that way. Please pray with me. Dear Jesus, thank you. Thank you for everything you have given me. Thank you for my family, for my time, for my toys, for my electronic gadgets, for my clothes, for my food, for my house. Thank you for those and so much more. Help me to remember that you have given me these gifts, and help me to find a way to share them with other people. Amen. And all God's people say,
Amen.
Yeah. Today's reading comes to us from the book of Ruth, chapter 2. Now Naomi had a kinsman on her husband's side, a prominent rich man of the family of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, "Let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain, behind someone in whose sight I may find favor." She said to her, "Go, my daughter." So she went. She came and gleaned in the field behind the reapers, and as it happened, she came to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Just then Boaz came from Bethlehem, and he said to the reapers, "The Lord be with you." They answered, "The Lord bless you." Then Boaz said to his servant, who was in charge of the reapers, "To whom does this young woman belong?" The servant, who was in charge of the reapers, answered, "She is the Moabite who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. She said, 'Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the reapers.' So she came, and she has been on her feet from early this morning until now without resting even for a moment." Then Boaz said to Ruth, "Now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Keep your eyes on the field that is being reaped and follow behind them. I have ordered the young men not to bother you. If you get thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn." Then she fell prostrate with her face to the ground and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your sight that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner?" But Boaz answered her, "All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. May the Lord reward you for your deeds, and may you have a full reward from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." And she said, "May I continue to find favor in your sight, my lord? For you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, even though I am not one of your servants." At mealtime, Boaz said to her, "Come here and eat some of the bread and dip your morsels in the sour wine." So she sat behind the reapers, and he heaped up her some parched grain. She ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. When she got up to glean, Boaz instructed his young men, "Let her glean even among the standing sheaves, and do not reproach her. You must also pull out some handfuls for her from the bundles, and leave them for her to glean, and do not rebuke her." So she gathered in the field until evening. Then she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. She picked it up and came into the town, and her mother-in-law saw how much she had gleaned. Then she took out and gave her what was left after she herself had been satisfied. Her mother-in-law said to her, "Where did you glean today? And where have you worked? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, "The name of the man with whom I work today is Boaz." Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "Blessed be he by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." Naomi also said to her, "The man is a relative of ours, one of our nearest kin." Then Ruth the Moabite said, "He even said to me, 'Stay close by my servants until you have finished all my harvest.'" Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, "It is better, my daughter, that you go out with his young women. Otherwise, you might be bothered in another field." So she stayed close to the young women of Boaz, gleaning until the end of the barley and wheat harvests, and she lived with her mother-in-law.
Please pray with me. Come, come, Holy Spirit, come. Open our hearts, our minds, our wills, our thoughts, our actions to you. Amen.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I had a friend. He and his wife are friends, actually. He and his wife were farmers many years in Woodbury. They were dairy farmers, and then they were beef farmers, and then they just raised some crops. As they got older, they rented out their land, but they stayed, as I think all farmers do, they stayed farmers. He was older than I was and often said this to me. He was probably one of the most insightful human beings I've known. I said to him, Glenn, I think you ought to be a therapist. You just know how to read people and know what's going on in people's lives. He was that intuitive. But he always said to me, over and over again, in all of our travels around Minnesota and just in his kitchen, he said, I'm not very smart. I'm not very smart. That's all he said. He really put himself down. And I said, Glenn, I look at it this way. Smart people are people who get good grades on tests, who really do well in that way. But I said, Glenn, you're intelligent. And I said, intelligent people have a sense of common sense. They have insight, and they're able to fix things that break down like farmers. And I said, you're an intelligent human being. Naomi, in this story, in Ruth's story, Naomi, this mother-in-law, the woman who went from Bethlehem to Moab and now back to Bethlehem, and she's feeling pretty hopeless, like God had abandoned her. Naomi was an intelligent woman, though. Even in her hopelessness, she was thinking beyond herself. She knew how to recognize people's needs. She saw it in her daughter-in-law, and she certainly saw it in the community now that she had reunited into. She knew what was needed and what was necessary, and she said to her daughter-in-law, well, you got to go out in the fields. We need some food and work and make sure you find a place that welcomes you. So Ruth, who provided her with companionship and grief support and purpose. Now it seemed to be Naomi's turn to return that favor by playing, as you'll hear, not just this week a little bit, but next week and beyond, matchmaker. An interesting piece of this story is within the traditions of that culture, the order of life back then. You see, it was common for God's people that they would work the fields, but they would leave some behind. And sometimes it was done unintentionally. They would just drop some of the grains of the wheat. And other times it was done with great intention because it was intended for those fields to have some in it for others who didn't have a field to come in there and pick up the leftovers, if you will, that what had been discarded, so that they too could have something to eat. Boaz, in this story, cared for Ruth and actually for other people in the need in his own community. The fields were harvested, but the workers always left produce for those in need to pick up. Do you ever go to a fast food store? I don't know if you've watched this, but I've watched this carefully because I'm usually looking for the little extra. Everything is carefully weighed. If you go to some of these sandwich places, they've got a scale, or they just have the exact amount already measured out, and that's all they put on there. You got to either ask them, which means you pay more for, but the idea is that you got to make sure that you have a margin of profit, right? Clerks are trained in the making sure that the exact amount of product are placed on the sandwich or in the particular drink. Waste, you see, is not good business, we would all say. Waste is not good business. Oversizing is not good business. You lose money. But God's economy, and it's always interesting how God's economy fits alongside our economy, it works differently. And Boaz and many others of his day were practicing that type of economy. In West St. Paul, there's a donut shop owned by a guy who was Vietnamese, and he's owned it for years, and it's just called Donut Shop. And when one goes in to buy a few donuts or a dozen donuts, He always looks at you and smiles, and then he places one or two extra in the bag. And in a sense, you almost expect it if you go in there enough, but it's always a surprise. What a treat, more than you have ever expected, now in the bag of donuts. The culture at Boaz's day lived under the understanding that one's own harvest provided a living and a well-being for yourself and for your family. But at the same time, it also offered an opportunity to care for others in the community. They trusted in God's abundance. Remember, in our confession, we said we don't always do that. They trusted that God would provide for them, so they were freed. They were freed so that they could share with others. Ruth, along with other people looking for food to survive, followed the workers in the field, picked up those pieces of grain that were intentionally left behind. They could have been chased away. They could have been arrested, perhaps, for trespassing and stealing. But no, that would have gone against the ancient law of God that we hear in Genesis chapter 12. I have blessed you, God said to Abraham and his new clan of people. I have blessed you so that, and that's important to hear those two words, so that you may be a blessing for others. In Chicago, I was walking around, going to the gas station just down the block to get something, and came across the street a Buddhist monk in his fine robes, his orange robes and his shaved head. And we began to have a conversation, because I'm not against having, as my children know, conversations with strangers. And he saw all of my keys. These are real. All of my keys. And he said to me, "Oh, you must have many things, because you have to keep them safe and locked up." And I was embarrassed, because frankly, first of all, I didn't know what these keys all worked on. I just had all these keys somewhere along the way. And I said, "Well, what do you do?" And he said, "Well, we live in that apartment building over there. We have a couple apartments, and we don't lock anything up. We don't lock our doors up. We just carry in our bag extra pair of chopsticks, socks, and a pair of sandals." And I was taken back by that. Now I'm feeling really guilty. And he said, "Because we don't lock it up, because if it's stolen or taken, we figure those people needed it more than we did." Interesting way of living. Boaz was a successful farmer. He was a wise businessman. And yet he lived out of a generous mindset. Living out of that direction, that way of seeing that God has given me what I have so that I can share with others. Living out of that kind of mindset, that God has blessed me to be a blessing, frees me from all the overconsumption and somehow absorption into my life that these things are the end all. It changes one's look on how you now use what you have. The couple that I talked to earlier about, the farmers, she gave Linda and I some crystal goblets that they got at their wedding over 50 years ago. And they were the kind, you know, where you wet your finger and just kind of go around like that and they make a sound. They were real crystal. And they were thin. And one day when we were eating together with them, Linda used those and one fell and broke. And I felt bad because they were given to us as a gift. And Linda felt bad because they were given to us as a gift. And I'll never forget what this woman, she got up from the table, and she was small in stature, and she said to us, she said, "Don't worry, they're only things. I too often put too much emphasis on those things. Maybe you do too. And that's why it's really hard, really challenging to live out this kind of life that God has invited us, that God has given us, to share what God has first given. The story of Ruth in the second chapter is a story about acceptance of those who are from the outside, yes, but it's a story about sharing what God has first given. And it is a story about how God includes all in that recipient life of generosity. Ruth and Boaz marry, by the way. This is the end of the story. And they get married, and then their children get married, and then they have children, and they get married, and they have children, and it's so many generations, and their descendant is a guy, a child, born in Bethlehem by the name of Jesus. A child, a Savior, who we all know was about sharing love and grace and mercy. Amen.
God of abundance, you make your creation thrive and grow to provide all that we need. Inspire us to care for our environment and be attuned to where the earth is crying out. Lead us to share our resources so that all may have what they need to fully live. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
God of mercy, your grace is poured out for all. Inspire authorities, judges, and politicians to act with compassion. Teach us to overcome fear with hope, meet hate with love, and welcome one another as we would welcome you. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great.
Please pray with me. God of mercy, your grace is poured out for all. inspire authorities, judges, and politicians to act with compassion. Teach us to overcome fear with hope, meet hate with love, and welcome one another as we would welcome you. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great.
God of community, we give thanks for this congregation. Give us passion to embrace your mission and the vision to recognize where you are leading us. Teach us how to live more faithfully with each other. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of care, accompany all who are in deepest need. Comfort those who are sick, lonely, or abandoned especially. Strengthen those who are in prison or awaiting trial. Renew the spirits of all who call upon you. Hear us, O God.
God of love, you gather in your embrace all who have died. Keep us steadfast in our faith and renew our trust in your promise. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Lord, who we hear at work through the story of Naomi and Ruth and Boaz, our Lord who came to us in Jesus, is one indeed who has blessed us and blessed us with great generosity. Our offering time is our time where we respond, the time, an opportunity for us to respond with thanks, a time for us to respond with our time, with our talents, to join in to further God's mission in the world. And with it, I want to say thank you for the great ways where God's generosity shines through you and how you live and what that allows and provides for us in ministry. I think of the innovation this week we were supposed to have on campus originally, Vacation Bible School. Well, because of your offerings this week, we've innovated and now it's the Buckets of Love Challenge, things that can be done each day. It provides us ways to respond to the needs of our community. Have initiatives like 40 Days of Prayer that are going on right now through July 10th. A blood drive that took place this past Wednesday here to provide blood that is needed and different opportunities to donate to care for those who are most affected in Minneapolis and St. Paul by the looting and the fires that had taken place there. Thank you for all the great ways where God's creativity shines through you. And so at this time, in those different ways, whether it's putting yourself out there to automate your giving or mailing in offerings, thanks for all the ways that you support this mission and ministry, and I invite you at this time to consider the ways that you offer your gifts. join together now in our offertory prayer. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Please pray with me the prayer that the Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As our time of worship here is concluding, again, we are sent out to carry out God's mission in the world. And our hope is that folks know God's amazing love in our lives that shapes how we live as followers of Jesus. And then we're sent out to be co-creators or partners, and knowing that God is already at work in this world. And you and I are called to join in so that all people can know God's amazing grace and love and justice and mercy. A couple opportunities I want to lift up for you currently is our hope is with what we do at home and as a community together, that people have a sticky faith, that is a faith that sticks with them, that shapes how they live and treat others. And so you'll see more information on emails and in the Grove newsletter and update. But we're looking for mentors for our high school and middle school students, I believe. You'll see more information that to be a sticky faith mentor to help pass along faith. Also want to remind you that every weekend we'll have online virtual worship available, and we'll be doing that for the foreseeable future. We're also at this time having on the second and fourth Sundays at 10 o'clock a drive-in worship service that'll happen this weekend. It'll happen the second and fourth Sundays of each weekend, so I invite you to come out and to be a part of that as well. And so with that, receive this blessing for your journey. Neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
Peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.